Let us breathe deeply for a moment. Inhale the autumn air. We're gathered today, among other things, to celebrate membership in this particular service. Various institutions will have varying bars of expectations. Some are rather low and some are higher. One of the keenest descriptions of a high bar of expectation comes from Annie Dillard in Teaching a Stone to Talk. And so I'd like to share that with you as our opening words. Why do people in church seem like cheerful, brainless tourists on a package tour of the absolute? Does anyone have the foggiest idea what sort of power we blithely invoke? Or, as I suspect, does no one believe a word of it? The churches are children playing on the floor with their chemistry sets, mixing up a batch of TNT to kill a Sunday morning. It is madness to wear ladies' straw hats and velvet hats to church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews. For the sleeping God may wake someday and take offense, or the waking God may draw us to where we can never return. Again, I invite us to breathe deep, to be still for a moment on the forming edge of our lives. We have an opportunity, either at this moment or perhaps in those singular moments of our lives when we focus, when we meditate, to still ourselves and to remember what is our essence, perhaps to even remember who we are, or perhaps who we wished we might have been. In those fleeting, rare moments, which is a privilege, we are striving to remember our authenticity. Authenticity. There's a lot of different notions about what is authentic. Who is an authentic human being? When am I truly being authentic? Curiously, this phrase has been splashed over various headlines over the past few weeks. I've actually been amazed. It's almost as if I predicted the amount of ink that was going to be devoted to this word authenticity. And I'll share with you several things that have been brought to my attention. One happens to do with a recent statement by Pope Francis. Pope Francis, speaking about the strife in the Balkans, says this. He spoke admirably of the, quote, climate of respect and mutual trust between the religions in Albania, which endured brutal religious oppression under communism, but today live and work together peacefully. It's noted that Muslims make up about 59% of Albania's population, with Catholics amounting to 10%, and Orthodox Christians just under that, according to the country's official figures. And then he says this, quote, "This is especially the case in these times where an authentic religious spirit is being perverted and where religious differences are being distorted and exploited," he noted. Again, "This is especially the case in these times where an authentic religious spirit is being perverted and where religious differences are being distorted and exploited." It stands to reason, does it not, that if something is authentic, other things must be fake. True? Given to me this week by Jackie Jackson is the fall edition of the European Unitarian Universalist Unifier. The title, or the main article, is entitled "The Search for Authenticity: Interviews with Young Adults," conducted by Martha Hicks. It begins with a quote attributed to Hugh Mason. "I've come to realize that, for me at least, the quest for quote-unquote authenticity is really a new spin on an age-old quest to find meaning and to do the right thing. It's a journey, not a destination, a process, not an answer." Several youth defined authenticity in these terms. One, his initial CB, says, being authentic means showing up as an unprotected presence, acting friendly to everyone when a person you want to impress is in the room, and then turning that off when the person leaves is really unacceptable behavior and not easily forgiven. JH says, it is sometimes confusing to know what authentic behavior is because the norms for authenticity are different depending on which country you are dealing with or which generation of people you are dealing with or even which sex you are interacting with. I believe it is relative, just like everything else. My voice changes depending on which language I am speaking. Which language I'm speaking, who I'm speaking to, and what I'm trying to accomplish. Does this mean I'm not authentic? I have many internal selves I need to be true to. There isn't just one. Maybe there is when you get older. Maybe that is what finding your identity means. And then there are another dozen quotes by young adults trying to grapple with what does it mean to be authentic? Most of us are above a certain age. Most of us have had to wrestle with that question, who am I? And perhaps our answers have changed depending on the circumstances. Who I was very different when I was 10 years old than here standing before you at 54. Who I am at 54 is very different than who I was at 22. And so for myself, and I suppose for many of you, there's been a process of discovery. And the more we've been pushed to explore deeper and deeper the inner lives and our spiritual essence, we have uncovered new layers of who we truly are. And so our sense of authenticity has evolved. True? Most people are shaking their heads. I'll take that as an affirmation. When we speak of an authentic religious presence, there are many, many different possible answers. Is it likely that you as a religious Unitarian Universalist who define yourself as an authentic person would come to the same understanding of what authenticity means as someone who is Jewish or Hindu, Roman Catholic, pagan? Perhaps there are some similarities, but perhaps there is a wide divergence. To be authentic is commonly understood that you are stepping beyond just the rules and regulations, the forms of religion, the formalism, the legalities, and that you are coming in contact with other people or with the holy, and that there is a transformation happening. And in that moment of transformation, you become a different person and your relationship changes. And at the root of that relationship is humility coupled with compassion. Forrest Church once said, if our religion doesn't inspire in us a sense of awe at the wonder of being, it has failed us or we it. Having received life as a gift, if we are not drawn to revere the presence of the same gift in others, there is something terribly wrong. And from that sense of wonder, we are not compelled to respond in some life-protecting, life-enhancing, life-affirming way, then we must go back and start over again until the wonder we experience proves itself authentic by the quality of our response to it. By the quality of our response. Would that it would be so easy. Would that we could teach one another to be authentic. Would that each authentic person respected everyone else in their authenticity. But there are so many different responses that are possible. Just like there are so many relatives in our family, some which we rush to embrace, some which we try to avoid. One prophet from the Hebrew Scriptures, Amos, said this as authentic as he could. He said, I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings, I will not accept them. And the offerings of well-being in your fatted animals, I will not look upon. Take away from me the note of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. For Amos, and there are many people like this, they are driven. They are driven to point out injustice in the world. That is their authentic voice. That is when they are being most true to themselves. They don't want the songs. They don't want offerings. They don't want people coming together like this. What they want are people in the streets, people with changed hearts, bringing justice to those who most desperately need it. There are other people who say, that is too much. You cannot push away people. We are a communal animal. We exist in a community, and we must learn to respect one another. And so it is politeness, it is graciousness, which is the lubricant of society. And we must learn to use that lubricant so that we can all get along. And if we can then get along, perhaps then we will commit our time, our treasure, our talents to working towards social justice or those other things that we aspire towards. You may know that in Unitarian Universalism, in this liberal tradition, there are four main principles that we aspire towards, and they are freedom, they are reason, tolerance, and they are love. When we speak of freedom, we are talking about intellectual freedom. We are talking about the ability to choose the creeds that we will believe in. We are heretics, and heresy means to choose. We choose what we believe is right. We do not say that nothing is right nor wrong. We say, through our experience, through our thinking, through all the different connections of our lives, all these different encounters, we have learned that there is a standard of good and evil. There is right and there is wrong. And because we are part of a community, we will test our notions of right and wrong against the notion of other people in community. That is the bond of covenant. So we're not just radical individuals. We're not following the apostles of individuality, Ralph Waldo Emerson and Henry David Thoreau. Rather, we are searching for authenticity in community and authenticity in covenant with one another. So freedom is very important to that search for authenticity. And each one of us will arrive at a different conclusion, more or less, about what is the core belief that motivates us that we serve. In addition to freedom, there is reason. And by reason, we mean intuition, our individual conscience. And it is very important in this tradition that we respond to our individual inner voice more than the collective. And this is not unique just to this tradition. Most traditions started with an individual, a man or a woman, who stood up and said, here I stand. This is the truth. And whether it was Martin Luther or Yashu in Palestine, or the Buddha, or some of the early seers in Hinduism, the Jewish prophets, they took a stand and they said, this is what I believe. This is what I'm called to serve. And ultimately, I will trust my fate and my conscience with that which I regard as holy. And that is an important part of this tradition, that ultimately, if other people bear upon you and say, you must conform, we, like Emerson, will say, let us be nonconformists. Even if we must suffer ostracism or being disconnected from the community, if it's that important, and after we've listened to other people, if we must choose a separate and unique path, so be it. Obviously, this makes for a lot of tension in a religious community. Obviously, in this tradition, when you have so many people who want to walk together, it sometimes is very, very difficult to walk together when other people are being pulled in different directions. In addition to freedom, in addition to intuition, there's also tolerance. Obviously, within this community, and in other communities all around the world, there's such a diversity of belief, such a diversity of practice, that we must embrace and celebrate these differences, and we must celebrate inclusivity. We must learn the art of toleration. Some do not like that word, and they dismiss the act of tolerating as something akin to, well, that's who you are, and I don't like it, but we'll try to put up with you. But that's not what religious toleration truly means. It means that we understand that different people follow different paths, and that different people are called by different things deep within, that we hear the silent voice whispering, calling us to be our best self, calling us to pursue truth. And in toleration, we seek to create a forum for different people to share the wisdom that they have acquired, that they have learned, so that we may all benefit from this. And finally, the fourth key virtue of the liberal tradition is love. And it's not a Hallmark version. It's not something you purchase, per se. Money can't buy you love in this sense. But it's the love that moves within a person, moved by compassion, to appreciate another person's struggle and suffering, and to stand with those people, to suffer with them, so that we may right wrongs. And that when people are in distress or in grief, we will provide a loving presence so that they know that they are not alone. You have compassion. You have intuition. You seek the truth. But the other component that Forest Church lifted up for us to consider is awe. We are more than just a Rotary Club. No offense to Rotarians here. We are more than just a political society or a debating society. This is a religious institution. Granted, so many of us come from different religious and spiritual paths, but what is foundational to all of us, I believe, is a sense of mystical wonder and awe about this universe. Give it the name that you must. Call it God. Call it spirit. Call it goddess. Call it the holy. Call it the sacred. You can even give it a more common name. Call it Jesus. Call it Billy. Whatever. Ultimately, this holy center of the universe, of which we are participants, should move within us a sense of awe. Not terror, not fear, but a sense of deep connection and deep wonder, and an understanding that there is something so much larger than ourselves that moves within this universe. Call it nature. Call it spirit. And we do not control that process. We are not larger than that, but at best we are a participant in this process. And once you have achieved a sense of awe, then you can achieve a sense of spirit and wonder that is shared by the naturalists, by the scientists like Carl Sagan, by the poets like Walt Whitman, by the essayists like Margaret Fuller. And you are inspired to cultivate a soul, to not be content with that which was born with you, but to be educated, to learn, to encounter through music, the arts, the sciences, through compassion and works of love and justice with one another. And insofar as we are willing to take those risks, to step outside the comfort of our lives, to take those risks, then we begin to understand the call of Annie Dillard about what an amazing opportunity this is to come together, to share with one another, to support one another, to take those risks. And insofar as we can do that, truly, we are furthering the blessings of creation. Thus has it always been, and thus shall it ever be. Amen. For our closing words, I offer you this insight by my colleague Catherine McTeague. May the light around us guide our footsteps and hold us fast to the best and most righteous that we seek. May the darkness around us nurture our dreams and give us rest so that we may give ourselves to the work of our world. Let us seek to remember the wholeness of our lives, the weaving of light and of shadow in this great and astonishing dance in which we all move. Amen.